everyone, and thanks for joining us for this earlier-than-usual edition of Speedweek. I'm Bob Jenkins. This weekend, the IRL, CART, the NHRA, and NASCAR's Winston Cup, Busch, and Truck Series all are in action, not to mention numerous other sanctioning bodies. The primary focus so far this week has been at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, where drivers are preparing to qualify for the May 25th Indy 500. Here's a look at what has transpired at the Brickyard through Thursday. Well, the track opened on Saturday with rookie orientation, the scheduled activity, but for the third time in 4 years, opening day was rained out. In the garage area, the big news was the new oil-absorbent diapers that line the undertrays of the cars. The IRL is mandating that each car carry the device, which also has a fire restraint heat shield. The mandate was in response to the high number of blown engines and subsequent oil leaks that took place in Phoenix. It was also announced on Saturday that Davy Jones had his halo restraint collar removed. His recovery from the January crash at Orlando continues to be ahead of schedule. The runner-up in last year's Indy 500 plans to spend time at the Speedway this month helping Team Gallus. On Sunday, Team Menard shocked everyone when they announced they were switching from Firestone to Goodyear tires. The team had put in over 4,000 testing miles on Firestones. In a less surprising move, the team announced that they had signed driver Tony Stewart through the 1998 IRL season. On the track, six rookies put in 256 laps. Vincenzo Sospiri and Kenny Breck completed four of the necessary five orientation phases, with Sospiri putting in the fastest lap of the day at 211.964 miles an hour. Heavy winds and rain limited Monday's activities. The wind was so powerful that it blew a piece of wood from the grandstand onto the track. Rookie Sam Schmidt clipped the piece but suffered no damage to his car. The first incident of the month took place on Tuesday when rookie Jeff Ward spun in his own oil and then hit the turn three wall. Ward was unhurt in the incident and returned in his backup car later in the day. That same day, many veterans got their first track time of the month with Ari Leyendyke leading the way. The 1990 Indy 500 winner put in a top lap at 218.707 miles an hour in his Aurora-powered Treadway Racing entry despite minimal off-season testing. Also on Tuesday, five rookies, Breck, Sospiri, Robbie Groff, Craig Ray, and Afonso Giafone completed the rookie orientation program while sprint car great Steve Kinzer signed on as Sinden Racing's second driver. On Wednesday, 1996 Indy 500 winner Buddy Lazier received his replica of the BorgWarner Trophy. His likeness has also been added to the one kept at the Speedway Museum. Scott Sharp became the second driver to crash at the Speedway. He had just completed a lap at over 217 miles an hour when a seized engine sent his car spinning into the turn four wall. The 1996 IRL co-champion walked away from the incident uninjured. Leyendyke set the pace again with a lap of 220.297 miles an hour. Off the track, Team Menard was contemplating a switch back to Firestone tires as pole contender Tony Stewart could only muster up a lap of 215.750 fifth overall. Now for an update on that story and on Thursday's activities, here's Dave Despain.
Okay, Bob, yesterday afternoon, big meeting in the garage area, Team Menard and Firestone. This morning, a standard 8.5 by 11 size press release. Firestone welcomes Team Menard back to the family. Yes, they are on Firestone tires. Tony Stewart's happy about it. Yesterday, he said of his misbehaving car, quote, "I'd just as soon sign autographs as go drive that thing," unquote. Today, Tony Stewart on the radio after getting back on the tires he tested for 2,700 miles here.
Got a race car back, boys. 10-4.
And the final word from the owner on all these tire tribulations?
Well, we aren't on Hoosiers yet, so that's the good news, I guess. It's no reflection on the Goodyear guys. They worked real hard with us and we're indebted to them, but we just felt we had to stick with what we knew this late in the week. And you know, it was a dumb decision in retrospect on our part, but we did it, and now we're back, and you know, that's that. I don't know what else to do.
Aside from Team Menard's tire tale, blown engines or lack of engines have been a limiting factor on a lot of team speed. That trend continuing today, internal parts becoming external with unfortunate frequency. Alessandro Zampedri was okay after going up in flames. That ended a great duel back and forth between Tony Stewart and Ari Leyendyke, in which they swapped fast speeds, though they only got up around 217 before the day was out. One of the pole favorites, Robbie Gordon, blew up very late in happy hour, eliminating any last-minute dash to 220. Ari Leyendijk, despite being quickest for the day and for the month, did provide us with some excitement today. What was that spin all about? Where'd that come from?
Well, I did learn something today about these cars and about leaving the pits on cold tires. The tires were cold. The track was obviously green because it had rained, and the track just didn't have much grip, and it was pretty windy. And besides that, I ran a little bit lower line. I wasn't even running fast. I ran a little bit lower. And the track has gotten quite bumpy a little bit lower off the line, and that's pretty much what caught me out.
How fast were you going when you lost it?
I wasn't going 200. I was probably going 190 or something like that. So it doesn't seem that fast because normally you run through there at 217 or so.
But I would think it would be scarier to lose it 20 miles off the pace and know that can happen to you. That's got to be a freaky experience.
Well, but like I said, all those factors played a role, and especially the bumps down there where I was driving, where normally on a quick run you wouldn't be down there. So I learned something from that today.
Okay, you're at 220. I've heard predictions from your camp of 222 for the pole. Nobody else is even close. Is it a race out here on Saturday, or should they just hand you the trophy and the check?
Well, I wish that was possible, but you know, we still have a race on our hands, I think, because I think that Team Menard is coming back. You know, they're trying to come back at us, and we always have to watch out for them because they've surprised me a few times.
The old saying, it's never over till it's over. Ari Leyendijk, thank you very much. Good luck for the pole.
Thank you.
Take a look at those speeds. You can see Ari way out in front of everybody else, but Team Menard coming after him after getting back on the familiar Firestones. They picked up the tempo significantly here this afternoon. Maybe the biggest news of the month, Bob, that'll come next week when the IRL announces new rules that may or may not extend an olive branch to cars. Back to you.
All right, thank you, Dave. The Friday before pole day has often been the most exciting practice session, and ESPN and ESPN2 have 4 hours of coverage from the Brickyard beginning at 12:30 Eastern Time. Later on Speed Week, we'll check up on the development of Riley and Scott's IRL chassis. Plus, it's up, up, and away with the NHRA.
DC. Get a $25 certificate from the Sharper Image when you buy four Firestone FT70C tires.
Welcome back to Speed Week. The NASCAR Winston Cup Series was at Sears Point Raceway on Sunday for the Save Mart Supermarkets 300. Mark Martin started on the pole and led the first three laps. On the fourth circuit, Rusty Wallace passed Martin with this move in the S's of the 12-turn road course. Two laps later, though, Wallace fell to fifth when he missed the turn seven corner and briefly drove off course. Rusty was a contender until lap 48 when a blown engine in his Miller Lite Ford ended his day. Martin led 69 of the 74 laps and held off a late challenge by Jeff Gordon to pick up his first Winston Cup win in 43 races. In the points battle, leader Dale Jarrett used a strong fourth place finish to maintain his advantage over Terry Labonte. Gordon remains in third, followed by Martin and Bobby Labonte. This weekend, the Winston Cup drivers return to Talladega to race the postponed Winston 500. ESPN's live coverage begins at 1:30 Eastern Time. Several of the Winston Cup teams headed down the California coast this week to check out Roger Penske's new California Speedway near Los Angeles. The D-shaped oval is similar to Michigan International Raceway and will host the California 500 on June 22nd. Rusty Wallace talked about his first impression of the Super Speedway.
When this race starts, I think you're going to see a whale of a race. We have a lot of passing in the straightaways. It's going to be a real drafting racetrack. And we're here doing the normal stuff, you know, just trying to get as fast as we possibly can, get it handled as best we possibly can, make some long runs, work on shocks and springs, a normal deal.
The NASCAR Craftsman Trucks paid a visit to Portland, Oregon for the Craftsman 200 last Saturday. Ron Hornaday jumped out to the early lead in front of pole sitter Rich Bickle. On lap 44, Bickle squeezed ahead of Hornaday and into the lead, where he would stay for the next 122 laps. Craftsman truck regular Tammy Jo Kirk had her most competitive weekend yet as she qualified third and ran with the leaders until this lap 177 crash with Joe Ruttman. She still managed to finish 14th. After Hornaday retook the lead on a restart, Bickle used this move to get past him for good as he led 136 of the 200 laps and claimed his first truck series victory. Saturday's win helped Bickle stretch his lead over Jack Sprague in the series point standings. Portland runner-up Ron Hornaday is third on the list ahead of Mike Bliss and Butch Miller. One driver who had planned on driving in Saturday's truck race was Toby Porter, but the 22-year-old rookie was seriously injured in a crash during Friday's practice session. Porter suffered a cracked first vertebrae in the accident and was fitted with a protective halo to help immobilize his neck and spine. Porter was released from Emmanuel Hospital in Portland on Tuesday. He's expected to wear the halo for 3 months before beginning physical therapy. The NHRA Winston Drag Racing Series held its inaugural Lone Star Nationals last weekend, and as Dave McClellan reports, there were a few drivers who had a hard time keeping their machines on the ground.
That's right, Bob. We began in the first round of pro stock elimination, where the near lane Mike Bell got out of the groove during his run against Scott Jeffrion. Bell's car hit the wall and rolled upside down, then skidded for a few hundred yards before coming to a stop. Bell was able to walk away from the incident unharmed. It was almost a dream weekend for Jeffrion as he advanced to the finals for the first time since early 1995. But his opponent, Warren Johnson, had a better reaction time and more horsepower. WJ's run of 6.98 seconds at over 198 miles an hour propelled him to his second win of the season and within 10 points of series leader Jim Yates. The wildest ride of the weekend belonged to Funny Car's Ray Higley. His car got airborne, lost its body, crossed the center line, and hit the wall. Higley was temporarily unconscious as his car then clipped the front end of John Force's vehicle. Both cars were damaged. Fortunately, Higley regained consciousness and escaped further injury. Force repaired his car and advanced to the finals where he faced Randy Anderson. The six-time Funny Car champ was quicker and faster than his opponent, but Anderson had a reaction time of .431. Remember, .400 is perfect. That allowed him to hang on and defeat Force for the second time this season. It was an eventful weekend for Top Fuel points leader Gary Selzy. First, his wife Julie gave birth to their first child, a son, on Saturday. Then on Sunday, he advanced to the semifinals against Joe Amato. Both drivers smoked their tires at the start, with Amato able to steer his vehicle a little smoother and straighter than Selzy. In the finals, Amato faced Larry Dixon, who was looking for his first national event win since April of last year. Amato regained his form of the earlier rounds as he blistered the quarter mile in 4.63 seconds at over 316 miles an hour to earn his third victory of 1997. For Speedweek, I'm Dave McClellan.
All right, thanks, Dave. This weekend, the NHRA is finishing their rain-shortened Pennzoil Nationals from 2 weekends ago. ESPN2 will have complete coverage of the event on Monday, May 19th at 7:30 p.m.
I'm Jackie White for Sabre Motor.
The NASCAR Busch North Series ran in Jennerstown, Pennsylvania Sunday. Tom Bowles qualified sixth quick, but after the redraw of the top qualifiers, he started the race on the outside of row one. Bowles used the outside line to take advantage and took the lead from pole sitter Dave Dion on the first lap. But Dion and Andy Santerre put pressure on Bowles throughout the race, but Tom was able to hold on to the top spot. Bowles went on to take the checkered flag and record his second career Busch North victory. Santerre finished in second. Dion ended up fifth. In other news, ARCA standout Tim Steele and NASCAR Busch Series owner James Finch are parting ways. Steele drove in six races in the Phoenix Racing Chevrolet. His best finish was a fifth at Las Vegas. As you probably know, the two chassis suppliers in the IRL are the Italian-made Dallara and G-Force of England. But in a few months, a third chassis will make its debut. The cars are being built by Riley and Scott, whose shop is just down the road from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. The modest facility at nearby Gasoline Alley has never been busier. In addition to their successful World Sports Car effort, they plan on debuting the new Hunter sports car soon. And they just signed a deal with Richard Childress to help in the design of his NASCAR teams. Despite the workload, the IRL effort is their primary focus.
We're working in design. We're also working on the chassis, on the mock-up tubs, and on the mock-up bodywork, and on all the rear suspension. We should be on the track hopefully in late June testing, and we'll be hopefully our first race will be at Charlotte.
And who do they hope to have in the cars?
The two that we know for sure, John Paul Jr. will be doing all the initial testing, then Stan Waddles will be running late in the season.
The ultimate goals at Riley and Scott are to win the Indy 500 and the 24 Hours of Le Mans. They'll debut at the Brickyard next year, but their workload has prevented them from entering in the June Endurance Classic.
There was one sacrifice we felt we had to make, was to not go to Le Mans this year because of the crunch time for the IRL project. We felt that would have stretched us too far.
Besides their growth, there's added pressure in the fact that Riley and Scott will be the only American chassis builder in the IRL.
In so much as that we need to be competitive straight away, and that's been the main thrust of what we've been trying to do. Do our homework as best we can, look at the competitors' cars, see where they stand, and just make sure that when we come out on the track that we can do American car constructors proud.
Early this summer, Riley and Scott will be moving their shops to a building that has four times the square footage as their current one. They hope to field 10 cars by the 1998 IRL opener at Orlando. Now let's take a look at the CarQuest racing calendar. Your auto parts needs, you'll find them at CarQuest. We begin tonight's short track segment with Saturday's USAC Western States and TQ Midget event on the pavement in El Cajon, California. It was an eventful night for TQ driver J.J. Irksey. In his heat race, he completed this 360 after going over a wheel. In the TQ feature, JJ climbed Jim Steiner's wheel, launching him into the fence. JJ fared better than the signboards. In the midget feature, Rick Hendricks beat pole sitter John Capps out of turn two. That's points leader Ricky Sheldon dropping back after contact with Scott Hansen. With just six laps to go, Hansen got around Hendricks for the top spot. The all-time TQ feature winner held on to record his first career Western States win and become the ninth different winner in 11 races. Round four of the NARC Golden State Challenge took place Saturday night in Calistoga, California. Bud Kading, the youngest son of Brent, took this wild ride in qualifying. He was okay and, in fact, returned later in a different car. Pole sitter Jason Lund got the jump on Randy Tyner at the start of the main event and led early. But on lap seven, Bobby McMahon shot past Lund for the top spot. McMahon's front wing came loose and eventually fell off. During a red flag for Craig Dillard's Tommy Tipover, McMahon was able to pit and replace the wing. Bobby held on to the lead and took the checkered flag for the third time this year, giving him the points lead. The Frigidaire All-Stars rode into Lincoln Speedway in Pennsylvania Saturday, and the B-Main Ed Lynch Jr. and Todd Gracie got together, sending Gracie into this wild series of flips. He was uninjured. Dave Blaney started on the pole of the 40-lap feature, but it was 17-year-old Tyler Walker grabbing the lead on the high side. Lance DeWeese blew past the youngster on the backstretch on lap three, but Walker battled back down low, regaining the top spot. Walker stayed down low and, with just three laps to go, was passed by the rim-riding DeWeese. Billy Pouch stole second from Walker on the final lap, but could not catch DeWeese, who pocketed the $4,000 top prize. The World of Outlaws were at Beaver Dam Raceway in Wisconsin last Sunday. Pole sitter Dave Blaney grabbed the early lead in the 30-lap feature. Following an Andy Hillenburg spin, Steve Kinzer rode the low line past Blaney and into the lead. Meanwhile, Mark Kinzer was on the move. After starting 11th, he quickly fought his way up to the third spot. Both Blaney and Mark got by Steve after he got loose in turn four, but the 14-time Outlaw champ got a run off turn two and retook the lead. But Steve again got sideways in turn four and surrendered the lead for good. Later, Mark Kinzer used traffic to get by Blaney and assumed the lead. Mark stayed in front for the remainder of the event and recorded his fifth Outlaw win of the year. The SCRA Traditional Sprints visited Las Vegas Motor Speedway for the first time Saturday. Rip Williams started on the pole for the 30-lap feature and moved out to an early lead. On lap nine, Steve Osling passed the Ripper on the high side for the top spot. But just two laps later, the two got together in turn two, sending Osling spinning. Williams went on to record his second straight SCRA win, followed to the line by Ron Schumann and Corey Kruseman. Kruseman is the SCRA points leader and is having one of his finest seasons ever. Corey is a second-generation driver whose father, Ron, lost his life in a racing accident when his son was 14. Recently, I visited Corey near his home in Ventura, California.
Corey, it would seem that somebody whose father was killed in racing would not be interested in that himself, but you are. Why?
Well, you know, when Ron got killed, he was a great inspiration to me. He was somebody I've always looked up to. And when he got killed, I've kind of always wanted to pick up where he left off. We've met a lot of people in racing, and it's kind of been a family to us, so it's hard to abandon the family.
What does your mom, though, think about this?
Well, she probably wasn't real sure of it at the get-go, but she's backed me 100%. She's always there for encouragement, so I think she's getting better and better with it as the years go on.
So where and when did you begin your racing career?
We started here in Ventura, and I was 15 years old. We started racing go-karts, and we moved up to the three-quarter midget division, and now we're running sprint cars full-time, and we're starting to race the Silver Crown Series a little bit last year, and we're going to run the full deal this year. So we're getting a little bit better where we want to be.
You had a terrible crash a couple of years ago at Sacramento. Again, that's something that it seems you would say, hey, enough of this for me.
Yeah, we did have a pretty bad one there. We were in Andy Bondio's car, and luckily it was a real belt race car that held up real well. And, you know, we broke a couple pieces and bumps and bruises, but other than that, we've come out with, I think, all of our good senses, so.
And I think there was a young lady who perhaps nursed you back to health, and then you married her, huh?
Yeah, me and Carrie, we met in high school, and we just got married a year ago, and she's taken pretty good care of me.
So now the career has taken off, and I guess we'll be seeing more of you in the Midwest this year than last year.
Yes, we're going to come back. We're going to run for Gardner Motorsports. We're going to run some of the pavement sprint car series, and we're going to do a little bit of dirt. Harlan Willis is going to bring his sprint car back, and we're going to run the Indiana Speedweek in July, and we're going to try to run the full Silver Crown series.
And what's the goal in racing for Corey Kruseman?
Well, you know, eventually I would like to make it to either the NASTRUC series, the IRL, or Winston Cup cars. But that's a lot of being at the right place in the right time. And luckily we've got Kerry Agajanian standing behind us right now. And with somebody as big as him, hopefully that's a real big step for me.
Yes. A promotional fee paid by Pikes Peak International Raceway. Opening our new 1 mile oval June 8th for USAC Silver Crown, midget, and super modified action. We're racing in the Rockies. Come join us.
And that will do it for this edition of Speed Week. We'll be back on Friday night next week with a Bubble Day preview from Indianapolis, plus Winston Cup and NHRA highlights from Talladega and Richmond. That's Speed Week next Friday night at 1:30 Eastern, 10:30 Pacific. And we hope to see you Saturday from Talladega. Don't forget, ESPN's coverage begins at 1:30 Eastern time. Have a great weekend. So long, everyone.